Good afternoon and welcome, Trinity Lutheran Church, and to welcome all those who are streaming. We just went online live. New world, right, Diane? Different world than we grew up in. But thank you for being here today. Every time we gather, I would say it's good that we're here. If we're here for worship on Sunday morning, if we're here for a baptism or a wedding, if we're here for a youth outing, or if we're here for a funeral, anytime we are here together, it's good that we're here because we're sharing the human journey together. Not all of those times are happy times, but even with that, it's good that we're here. We've gathered today, it's the 13th day of October, and we've come to celebrate Carl's life. We've come to mark the rich, productive seasons of his life. Seasons shared with the love of his life, Diane. It's good that we're here, but we'd rather be almost anywhere else today, wouldn't we? October 13th, 2024 is Carl's 72nd birthday. We received new members at the services today, the worship services, and it was just 1 year ago, in October of 2023, when Carl and Diane stood right here by the baptismal font, and that day they became members of Trinity Lutheran Church. It's a reminder to us of how precious life is and how fleeting life is as well. We've come to celebrate Carl's life, a life well lived, but truth be known, we're still reeling from the shock and grief of his untimely death. And so we gather with you, Diane, and with your family, both here and online. At this time of loss, the reality of death reminds us all of our own mortality as well. We celebrate his life and we grieve. We gather in this place, a safe place, Carl and Diane's place of worship. And here, surrounded by the symbols of Carl's life, together today we will claim the promises of God, praying that those promises may sustain us as we continue on in our journey in life. A reading now from the book of Isaiah, the 43rd chapter, kind of a love letter from God to Carl and to all of us. Thus says the Lord, he who created you, he who formed you, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I've called you by name, you are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you, and through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you. For I am the Lord, your God, your Savior. You are precious in my sight and honored, and I love you. Let us pray. Good and gracious God, we give you thanks this day for our brother Carl. We give thanks for the rich seasons of his life and for the privilege of sharing this journey with him. Console us now as we mourn, that we may continue our journey on earth until one day we are reunited with Carl and with all those who have gone before us. We pray into the mystery of life and death, trusting in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Scattered through the service, we have several pieces of music. The music will be accompanied by some video remembrances of Carl's life. I think you'll smile, not only by the music, but also by the video remembrance. And all the pieces of the music were chosen by Diane. This is the music of Carl and Diane's life. And we begin with Don McLean.
I feel a trembling tingle of a sleepless night creep through my fingers, and the moon is bright. Beams of blue come flickering through my window pane. like gypsy moths that dance around a candle flame. And I wonder if you know that I never understood that although you said you'd go until you did, I never thought you would. Moonlight used to bathe the contours of your face, while chestnut hair fell all around the pillowcase. The fragrance of your flowers rest beneath my head, a sympathy bouquet left with a love that's dead. And I wonder if you know that I never understood that although you said you'd go until you did, I never thought you. Never thought the words you said were true. Never thought you said just what you meant. Never knew how much I needed you. Never thought you'd leave until you. With no regret, and evening brings the memories I can't forget. Empty rooms that echo as I climb the stairs, and empty clothes that drape and fall on empty chairs. And I wonder if you know that I never understood that although you said you'd go until you did, I never thought you would.
Very beautiful. Thank you to Carl's family and to Laura Canby for putting that together. Words now from the Old Testament. These are words that have brought, given comfort and hope to people of faith for 3,000 years. The 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in right pathways for his name's sake. And even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely your goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long. Beautiful words. Celebrating and giving thanks for Carl's life is important. I think the videos enmeshed with the music is a way to do that. We also have some remembrances to read this day, and I'm gonna start that off at this time, and Tracy will come up in a few minutes as well. But the first remembrance that I have is from Greg Wilson. Greg writes these words. I had the pleasure of working with Carl at Kenworth for several years. 2017 was a particularly fun year for both Carl and I. We spent most of the year traveling together throughout the United States, training swift transportation technicians. It was during this year that I realized Carl's priorities and loves in life. Number one was Diane. Number two, his dogs. Number three, his Harley. Prior to his retirement, Carl fought a hard battle against cancer. He barely missed a day of work, and at times, given his condition from the treatment, I wasn't sure my buddy was going to make it. Fortunately, he did, and we were able to celebrate the end of his career with a joyous retirement party. Carl had a tough outside, but his true colors showed through that day, and he shed a couple of tears along with the rest of us. I was happy to see Carl enjoy his retirement and travel the United States in his elite motorhome. He and Diane graced us with a visit in Idaho in 2021. We took them to a couple of local wineries and had dinner at their campground. It was great to see Carl happy and enjoying retired life. Diane's message to me, making me aware of Carl's passing, came as a complete shock that I still can't fully get my arms around. Carl was a great person, a great husband, a great friend, a great coworker, and he will be truly missed. Rest easy, old friend. Love, Greg. And Debbie and Steve Ayers write these words. We met Carl through taking Diane's classes and have stayed in touch through the years for walks and meals. Carl was a kind and friendly man. He had a nice smile and a fun-loving spirit. He loved his motorcycle and taking many trips on it. He rode out west and during the Oyster Run. He had a spirit for adventure, as shown in many trips in their RV. He loved the dogs over the years. He had a special bond with Skye. I remember one time on a walk, a loose dog came up to Skye, and Carl knew exactly what to do to keep Skye safe. Diane and Carl worked in sync on many things: the yard, cooking, and caring for the dogs, to name a few. It was obvious to us that Carl loved his life. We will miss seeing Carl. Love, Debbie and Steve. And Johnny writes these words. Hello, Carl. It's me, Johnny, your son-in-law. First and foremost, I'd like to give all the praises, all the honors and glory, with thanksgiving to the Almighty Father in heaven for guiding us here safely to celebrate your special day. I strongly and faithfully believe that you are in the hand of Almighty Father God in heaven at your everlasting home at this time. Your calling was so soon. I am so lost in words to express my gratitude for all the good things you have done, especially allowing me to be a part of your family. Marrying your daughter was the greatest thing that has ever happened to me in my whole life. Meeting you for the very first time while you were traveling to California for your work was quite an experience. I was very nervous and did not know how and what to say to you before we met. I remember when you asked me at the restaurant during our first dinner prior to marrying her, you said, "So what kind of work do you do?" I said, "I work part-time at a nightclub as a bouncer." I look after the club, maintain the safety of the customers and staff, which includes physically throwing violent and disorderly drunks out of the building. At that moment, your daughter stepped on my foot, trying to tell me to stop. And then your facial expression had changed drastically. You had given me this look that appeared to be saying, "What the hell are you doing with my daughter?" From that point on, I was always would watch myself with every word I said and move when I that I made when I was around you. I have 24 years of memories to share. However, I'm limited with time. I wish you well with your journey. I did not have time to say goodbye, to tell you that you were the best dad and the best granddad to your three masterpieces that God has blessed me with. So long for now. May God be with you. Love, Johnny. And then some remembrances from Carl's sisters. Debbie. I think about my brother growing up. He was quiet and didn't say much, but when he did, you knew it. He could be funny and have me laughing so hard. I knew he was always thinking, and later in life it showed. I looked up to him because he was smart. I miss him even though I didn't see him that much, but he was my brother and will always be with me. Love you, Carl. Debbie. And Sister Kim writes these words. Oh, I'm sorry. Brother Kim writes these words. I always looked up to my big brother, Carl. I remember going to the theater when we were kids. I was 5 and he was 9. He would leave me in the balcony by myself while he ran off with his friends. I'm still afraid of snakes to this day, as he used to wrap snakes around my neck. Carl was a great storyteller, and I got to hear one of those stories 2 weeks before he passed. I'm so glad we got to know each other again as adults. You'll be missed, big brother. Love, Brother Kim. And now Tracy.
Dad, I look in the past and I see a man who lived a fulfilling life. I'm so grateful that I was able to spend 52 years of my life with you, even through our differences, my rebellious stages. From when I was small to when I married, to when I became a mom, to watching my own children grow into your heart. Your silliness and tenacity to be the best you could be always showed. Oh, sure, you were stubborn. We all know that's where I get it from. Definitely frugal, and again, where I get it from. A comedian at heart, and again, where I get it from. You had the passion to enjoy life and see all that you could possibly get the chance to see. Again, where I get it from. You taught me well. You taught me how to dream big and then go after it. There are now so many lasts that I think about, as well as so many firsts. There are also so many nevers, which I try not to think about as it crushes my heart. The last Christmas we spent together, but also the best Christmas there was. The last birthday dinner we had together, but also the best dinner ever. The last phone call we had together, the last camping trip together, the last car ride together, the last father-daughter moment, the last pictures of the kids I sent you, the last video of the kids playing sports, the last text message, the last hug, I know, the last goodbye. I will now move forward with the first birthday, with you not here in person. The first year, you will not call and sing a happy birthday to me or the kids. The first Thanksgiving where we don't get to enjoy your cooking. The first Christmas break we won't spend together as a family. And the first year, I will not be able to hear about all your adventures on the road. But with all these firsts, there will be all your memories that you have filled in my heart, soul, and mind to make these next years a little bit easier without you. Another thing I learned from you is to not dwell on the bad things and to move forward with your head high and make the most of it no matter what. I can hear you in my head right now telling me to not make this too long. I need to make it short, sweet, and to the point. Just know, Dad, that you did a great job providing for your family, and I will miss you with all my heart. Your job is done on this earth. You made amazing impressions in many people's lives. I will see you again soon. Rest in peace, and know that we will be okay, too. Over time. I'm going to read this for my daughter, Anna Lucia. Memories of my grandpa, going camping with you on many different trips, spending Christmas break with you. My favorite memory is when you were at our house and you took me to the Annalisa Park. We found a stick that looked like antlers. We were silly together and pretended that we were deer. Your last birthday, when we all went to the hibachi together, you even wore the birthday balloon. I love you, Grandpa, from Annalisa. To start off, I would like to say that if you can hear me, I love you, Grandpa. I love everything that I've ever done with you because you always made sure we had a good time even during the sad days. I would have to say that one of my favorite memories would be every time we saw you, you would take me to go play basketball, and that was a lot of fun, even though I would always beat you. I also loved it when you would just make a joke about everything. I know you had to leave early in your life, and yeah, I'm sad about it, but I must stay strong and make jokes to keep my family happy, just like you would have done. My number one memory is when you came to my house and dressed up as Santa Claus and brought a huge bag of presents. It's hard to choose my favorite memories because we have had many together, like when you taught me how to build a birdhouse for the first time. I do wish you were still around so I can call you and listen to your jokes again. I think what makes me sad is that we won't be able to make any more of those memories anymore because you're not visible to us anymore. I also feel very bad because I never got to say goodbye to you. I would always say, see you soon, but I won't anymore. So this is goodbye now. I'm gonna miss you, Grandpa. Love, your favorite grandchild, Z. When I think of my grandpa, I think of jokes and happy times. But sadly, my grandpa's no longer in this world. I've been feeling different kinds of emotions lately, sad, angry, confused. I miss the days when we went camping, when we played basketball, and when he was with me. I wish I could just grab onto him and give him the biggest hug, just one last time, before God let him pass through the gates. But I enjoyed the time I had with him, and I want him to know that he was the best grandpa that anyone could ever have. I know I cause a little trouble every now and then, but that did not stop him from loving me. He left behind many great memories to keep. I will be sad that he is gone, but I should be happy that he lived a great life. I wish I could talk to him. I wish I could help do yard work again. I wish that I can go on one more walk. I wish I can play one more game of horse. I will miss him, and I want him to know that I really miss him. He brought a lot of joy to the world, and he made me feel happy. I wrote this for you, Grandpa, and I hope you like it. Goodbye from me, Josiah Fanini, to you, my one and only Grandpa. And I will see you later. We will play basketball together again, but we will just have to wait. Rest in peace, Grandpa. JoJo.
Tracy, a beautiful labor of love. Reading that was hard to do, thanks to the grandkids as well. Anybody else want to share anything? I'm going to give Diane the last word here, but there's going to be a reception afterwards. You're going to get coffee and cookies and share stories together at that time as well. Beautiful display out in the narthex. It'll bring a smile to your face as well. Diane wrote these words on December 4th, 1998, for their 27th anniversary. It's a poem called Our Time. A card can't begin to say the words I spoke to you today about life and love and our marriage strong, a bond so real, a bond so strong. It takes a special magic to make love last this way, and I just want to tell you, I wouldn't have my life any other way. You've been my friend, my love, my all. We've laughed, we've fought, we've had a ball. We've mastered the tough times, breezed through the good, made sense of nonsense, and raised two good kids. Through it all, the ups and downs, when most would have thrown in the towel, for that alone, I love you so. For that, you've let me grow. You've let me be me and spark my interest wide. We've learned together and apart and still, together, whole in every way. Without you in my life, it would be an empty place. It would be hard to run the race. You are all to me, it's true. You were my life, my dream come true. I thank the Lord for bringing you into my life. We've explored so much together, making memories and magic all. These times are made more special because I had you to share them all. A book couldn't begin to say all the things I have inside. And so every day I want you to know I love you with my heart, my mind, my soul. Love, Diane. And now, Elvis.
Can understand me when everything I do is wrong. You give me hope and consolation. You give me strength to carry on. And you're always there to lend a hand in everything I do. That's the one. The wonder of you.
Wonder of you.
And when you smile, the world is brighter. You touch my hand and I'm a king. Your kiss to me is worth a fortune. Your love for me is everything.
The Apostle Paul writes these words in the 8th chapter of Romans. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will affliction or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? No. In all these things, we are more than victorious through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. Nothing. Hold on to that for a minute. He was the third. Carl the third. Born to Eloise and Carl the second. He was born on a Monday, the 13th day of October in Cadillac, Michigan. And as his mother held this precious gift from God close to her breast that day, giving thanks for a safe labor and delivery, giving thanks for a baby boy, the life expectancy of a baby boy in the United States in 1952 was just 66 years. Born in Cadillac, Michigan, it was the glory years for the U.S. automakers, a boom time, topping the music charts, Doris Day, Perry Como, the Mills Brothers, Percy Faith, and Nat King Cole. That's right, it was a time before rock and roll. Bill Haley was just in the process of putting together the Comets, and Elvis was unknown. 1952 was a good year for babies. Christopher Reeve, Dan Aykroyd, Roseanne Barr, and country star George Strait were all in Carl's birth class. When Carl was born, he won the birth lottery. He was born in a land of freedom and opportunity, a loving family, safety and security. He had a lot going for him. He was smart, good-looking, healthy. But his biggest break in life came when he least expected it. He found the love of his life while he was still in high school. Diane and Carl were high school sweethearts. On December the 4th, 1971, in Cadillac, Michigan, Carl and Diane would hold hands and they would exchange sacred promises. They would promise to see the seasons together, whatever joys and sorrows lay before them. They would face it all together, arm in arm, hand in hand, for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health, to love and to cherish, until death would part them. For the next 53 years, through all the changes of life, Carl and Diane would be faithful and loving to each other. It is a beautiful thing when the overarching story of one's life is a love story. Carl and Diane's life is most fully understood and defined by a love story. Carl was a good man. We've heard that already. A teacher, a chef, a patriot, a motorcycle enthusiast. He was always ready to head out on the Harley. The adventure of travel ever before him. The open road always calling to him. Carl enjoyed life and he enjoyed retirement, and the past 25 years Whidbey Island has been his home, Langley his town. Carl died suddenly on September 3rd. And as the tears today bear witness, we don't take kindly to death. It's not about a lack of faith. It's just that we detest death, which robs us of our loved ones, robs us of future joys, and years of companionship. His death was a shock to all who knew him. He had gone to Walmart in the morning, worked with Diane in the yard in the afternoon, made and enjoyed dinner, and then just like that, he was gone. Gone too soon from our human perspective, leaving a hole in Diane's heart, leaving a hole in his family, in our community, in our neighborhood, and in our lives. We celebrate his life. We celebrate the love story that defined his life. We celebrate the story of a life that was well lived, the story of a good man who loved to cook and travel, motorcycles, and family. And we grieve. We grieve his loss. There is a hole in our hearts. But finally, we claim the promises of God. The promises of God. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. Not cancer, not addiction, not bankruptcy, and certainly not death. We claim the promises of God, and those promises are very simple. If you read the Bible from cover to cover over and over again, we are not promised a life without betrayal, or without war, or without disease, or without dementia. We are only promised three things in the Bible: that we are loved, that we are forgiven, and that we're never alone. We are loved by God even when we're not sure we love ourselves. Even when it seems that no one else in the world loves us, we are loved by God. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. And we are forgiven. We are forgiven of all of our sins. In the book of our lives, all of our lives, there's a few pages, sentences, or chapters which we regret. Words that we should have spoke that we didn't. Actions that hurt us or hurt those that we loved. But God's promise is that we are forgiven. We're forgiven even when we look back in the mirror and can't forgive ourselves. Even when no one else will forgive us, we are forgiven by the blood of Jesus. We are loved, we're forgiven, we're never alone. Carl was not alone on September 3rd. He was safe in his own home. He was safe with Diane. He was not alone. And in a mystery beyond our understanding, in a time that seems too short for us, in the twinkling of an eye, he crossed over to the other side. But he was not alone. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil, for God is with me. And God was with Carl in that moment, taking his hand and taking him to eternal life. So Carl, thank you for sharing the journey with us. We're not going to say goodbye forever right now. We're just going to say so long until we see you again. And we will see you again on the other side. May God be merciful to us in our grief. Thanks be to God. I would invite you to join me in praying together now as Jesus taught us to pray the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And now a final prayer. This is a prayer called the Prayer of Commendation. It is commending Carl to Almighty God. Let us pray.